The stars are right, and that means it's time for another episode of The Whisperer in Darkness. I'm your host, The Man from Leng. Thank you very much for joining me today. Hopefully everyone on YouTube can see me now. Seems to be a little on the slow side. I see some people are also coming in on Twitch, so that looks good. This is the first time I have tried Restream, so I'm hoping that all of the technical issues go okay. Drop me a line in the chat to just let me know if things are working all right, and we will get started. And here we are. We are set up and ready to go here in Octagon. As I mentioned on the stream announcement, I am playing Luke Robinson today. We do not know his deck building restrictions, but so we have decided to go all Mystic with Luke here. We'll take a look at his deck quickly and see what we've got here. We've got, of course, his weakness detached from reality. We have a couple copies of Unexpected Courage, two copies of Prophecy, hoping we can get those two wild icons working for us. Couple copies of Guts. Now, one of the things I encountered while building this deck is there aren't a lot of great events that let you target connecting locations. A lot of the events that you can include are just generic good stuff decks. Good stuff that go in Mystic decks, like Ward of Protection, Deny Existence, and Uncage the Soul. We do have a couple copies of Drawn to the Flame in there. That is one of our main ways of collecting clues at connecting locations, and as well as a copy of Storm of Spirits. I decided not to go with two copies just because it's a little too expensive for three resources. What else do we have in this deck? We've got a couple copies of David Renfield for resources, a copy of Arcane Initiate if we need to find some spells, two copies of Holy Rosary, and we're going with the full the new Mystic Suite here. We've got Wither, Sixth Sense, and Shriveling. Welcome, Michael. Glad to see that you could make it out to the stream today. And we are playing with two copies of Sign Magic because we are going to need that that extra arcane slot in case we want to get down Withering, Sixth Sense, and Shriveling all at the same time. And I've also put in a couple copies of Fine Clothes just because we are going to play the extracurricular activity, and Luke does not have a great intellect. He's got an average of 3, so we will need a little bit of help if we are going to find our friendly janitor hidden in the deck somewhere. I won't bother going over Dunwich Legacy here, extracurricular activity. I think most players are familiar with it by now. We've got Orin Library, Humanities Building, Miskatonic Quad, Student Union, Science Building, and Administration Building. I chose this particular scenario just to see how Luke's movement with his gate box will work. And I may also play Curtain Call if time permits, because I think that's another good scenario to see how his movement works, especially if you have to shift from one side of the map to the other. I like the idea of dealing with the man in the pallid mask and then immediately being able to jump over to the lobby to deal with him again. So welcome, Ben. Glad you could make it. We are playing Luke Robinson. He is the Dreamer. He's got 4 willpower, 3 intellect, 2 combat, and 3 agility, Dreamer, Drifter, and Wayfarer traits. We begin the game with the gate box in play, and you may play one event each turn as if you were at a connecting location and engaged with each enemy at that location. His Elder Sign effect is +1. and you place one charge on the gate box. Yep, this video should be archived on YouTube if the technology works out okay. This is the first time I've used Restream with YouTube, so I'm hoping that the video will be archived over on YouTube as it always is. Otherwise, we'll figure out some other system to make sure that we can get everybody on, everybody gets to see it. We have our gate box, which is, of course, Luke Robinson deck, only uses three charges, and as a free triggered ability, we can exhaust gate box and spend one charge to disengage from each enemy. Engage with you, search your bonded cards for Dreamgate, Wondrous Journey, and put it into play and move to it. The Dreamgate is a bonded card, which means it is connected with the gate box. If you don't have the gate box, you don't have the Dreamgate. And Dreamgate is connected to each other revealed location and vice versa. Enemies and investigators other than Luke Robinson cannot enter the Dreamgate. And as a forced effect at the end of the investigation phase, you set Dreamgate aside out of play, and if Luke Robinson is here, move him to any revealed location. So good stuff here. Hopefully we'll be able to use the Dreamgate to bounce. My plan is to do the loop, go Humanities Building, Orn Library, down to Student Union, and then back over to the Administration Building and whatever that other location is. It escapes my memory here for a second. And then use our Dream Box just to get back to the Students Union so we can head down and save the students. I think we are ready to go here. I haven't drawn a weakness for this deck, so we will do that now. Let's shuffle up our weaknesses and see what we get. We have, the thing that follows. It is that basic weakness from the Path to Carcosa. It has 3 fight, 2 health, and 3 evade. Spawns at the location farthest from you. Prey is bearer only. It is a hunter, and when the thing that follows would be defeated, we shuffle it back into our deck instead. And it will hit us for 1 damage and 1 horror. So we'll shuffle that in. As I mentioned at the top of the video, we do not know Luke Robinson's deck building requirements, but it's safe to say he can use Mystic cards, so this deck is just Mystic cards only. Not sure whether he will be able to use any other class cards. He doesn't seem, he certainly doesn't seem like a Guardian to me. Maybe a Seeker? I could see, you know, Seekers do have quite a few events, so maybe Seeker fits in with his theme. Obviously not a Rogue, and he is a Mystic. And of course, Survivor is one of those classes that seems to fit in with pretty much any Investigator, you could almost say, as a Survivor. But we've already got a Survivor Mystic in Agnes Baker, so I don't know if we will be getting any more Seeker cards in Luke. Yeah, Michael, I think he is going to be fun to play. He is able to zip around the map quite a bit. And especially once I'm not playing Open Gate in this deck just because I don't think it's going to be very useful. And I don't know how many copies of Open Gate we get to play. I assume it's going to be more than 2, but I don't know that. So I decided to leave it out. And I think Open Gate is going to be more valuable in multiplayer than it will be in solo, where Luke can simply rely on his gate box to get around. I think we're ready to draw our opening hand, so we'll do that now. Let's see how we do. Hi, John. Welcome to the stream. We've got Guts, David Renfield, Deny Existence, Uncage the Soul, and a Drawn to the Flame in our opening hand. Like the look of David and the Uncage the Soul, I think we can probably mulligan the other 3, and we'll see what we get here. There's an Unexpected Courage, a Fine Close, and our weakness, which we will redraw for. And we get a Sixth Sense. Okay, so we've got We've got to Sixth Sense so we can do some investigating. We've got our fine clothes so we can set up our play with Jazz Mulligan. We've got an Uncage the Soul so we can play our Sixth Sense for free. All we are missing is some sort of we need a weapon of some kind. We do have Wither and Shriveling in the deck. So we are ready to start here. I am using Marie Lambeau's as a placeholder here. So don't get confused. We are going to take our first action. We'll use Uncage the Soul to play Sixth Sense. So we do have our investigation online right away. And that is free with Uncage the Soul. Now, do we play David now? Or do we wait? Because we've only got 4 willpower. That's not great. We don't get any bonuses using Sixth Sense. So maybe we will take another action to get to. I think we're just going to take a turn. Yeah, John, I'm just assuming he's pure mystic, that he can use at least mystic cards. So that's all we've got in the deck for this particular playthrough. Once we find out his deck building restrictions, I'll probably play him again. But I'm assuming he's going to be a pure mystic. So we've got David Renfield down as our second action, and then we will, I guess we will add a doom to him to gain a resource and gain another willpower. So we are up to 5 willpower. Pretty good start so far. We've got one action remaining. I don't want to go to the humanities building because as long as I keep no clues on the table, I can avoid the thralls. So we will take another action and we'll simply play our fine clothes to get that down now as well. All right, that is going to be our turn. Pretty good opening turn. No enemies, of course. Upkeep, there is our copy of Sign Magic. So that is going to be awfully nice. We're doing pretty well in the resource department thanks to that Uncage the Soul. So we can get another arcane slot if we need it. All right, let's go on to the Mythos phase. We'll add a doom. So we've got 2 of 7. Our encounter card is going. Oh, geez, that's not good. All right, so we've got a Yithian. We have a Yithian. Now, that is bad news. Yithian, of course, 4 fight, 4 health, 3 evade. Monster Yithian, his prey is the fewest cards in hand, and when he attacks us, we have to discard a random card from our hand. Otherwise, he deals a damage and a horror. He's worth a victory point, and he hits us for a damage and a horror. Now, this might be our first test of the gate box here. If we can, we get to disengage, move to the Dream Gate, and then when we're at the Dream Gate, connected to each other revealed location. Okay, that's not going to work for us. So this could be. We do have three agility. So our gate box is not going to get us out of this fix. We will need to try to evade, and we've got an unexpected courage. That's probably going to be what we need. This game could be over before it begins if we can't get away from this thing. Let's see. Let's make sure we get our David Renfield money. First of all, I'm not going to add another doom to him. I'm content with what we've got right now. We are going to have to evade the Yithian as our first action. So we will commit our unexpected courage to that. That will give us a 5 versus 3. So we're 2 up. That's pretty good. Assuming we don't get a really bad draw from the chaos bag, we should be able to get away. Let's see what the chaos bag has to say. It gives us, oh, there's a tentacle. Of course. Of course. Well, that was a massive failure. And now we are in trouble because we have It's going to be 3 versus 3. The Chaos Bag is still on this particular scenario. It's okay. So we may be able to get away from him still. Let's try to evade the hard way. Chaos Bag says +1. Okay, well, so we got a tentacle on the one and a +1 on the other. So this guy will be evaded, fortunately. And we will move as our final action over to the Humanities Building. Humanities Building being a 3-shroud location with 2 clues, and at the end of your turn, if you are in the Humanities Building, discard the top card of your deck, where X is the amount of horror on you. So we managed to get away from the Yithian Observer. Unfortunately, our gate box wasn't able to help us there, and that Yithian is going to hang out in Miskatonic Quad, so we're going to have to try to figure out a way. We're going to have to go back through there. So we're going to need another, maybe an Unexpected Courage or a Prophecy to get through that. Or perhaps just draw another +1. That would always be, it's also an option. Nothing during the enemy phase. We ready during upkeep and we draw another copy of Uncage the Soul. That's pretty good. If we get a weapon, then we could... just simply kill the Yithian for those juicy victory points. Let us head over. We need to add a doom first. So we are at 3 of 7. Our encounter card for this turn will be, there is an Ancient Evils, place a doom on the agenda. So that will be easy enough to do. All right, so we've got 4 doom of 7 already. We will be able to get some clues, however, this turn, I think. So we get our 3 actions. Let's make sure we get our David Bucks here while we've got him. Now we are going to do some investigating. Sixth Sense doesn't require any charges, so we will use our willpower instead of our intellect. And if we draw one of these special symbols, we can choose a revealed location connected to our location, and we can investigate that location instead. So we are going 5 versus 3 at the Humanities Building. Chaos Bag gives us a -1, so that will be enough to grab a clue. As a reminder, we do need 3 clues in order to advance Act 1A, so we will need to clear this Humanities Building as well as Ornn Library. Let's do it again. We have 5 versus 1. Another tentacle. So 2 tentacles in the first 3 turns. That's not great. I guess we're going to have to simply investigate again since we are stuck here. And we will get another -1. So 2 tentacles in the first 3 turns, but we do grab the 2 clues off the Humanities Building. We're not going to be taking any, we're not going to have to discard any cards this turn because we haven't taken any horror yet, so that's good. And hi Maverick, thanks for coming out today to watch. We've got, that was our investigation phase. We've got the enemy phase, nothing happens. Upkeep, we get Holy Rosary. So now we can boost our willpower up to 6 if necessary. We've got plenty of resources thanks to David Renfield. We just need to be able to get either a weapon or some sort of skill like a prophecy or an unexpected courage to help us with this Yithian Observer. If we can get by the Yithian Observer, let's see. Yeah, that's such a bad position for him because we have to cross through there like so many times. We'll have to go through there at least once, possibly twice more this game, until we can use the gate box to get through. All right, well, let's go on to the next Mythos phase. We've got 5 of 7, and our next card will be, there is a Thrall. So a thrall is two fight, two health, and two evade, but it spawns at the location with the most clues, which is one of the reasons why you really want to try to leave no clues on the table in the Mythos phase, because now we can dump this guy wherever we need to. Let's throw him up here in the science building, because I do not plan to go there unless we really if we run into trouble with Jazz and we can't get him by going to the Students' Union building, we'll try to get him at the administration building instead. All right, that was an easy Mythos phase. We will move on to the investigation phase. We've got three actions. One of them is going to be to move up to the Orin Library. We flip that over. Orin Library, three shroud location with one clue, and we must spend an additional action to investigate the Orin Library. It's worth a victory point. So we're going to have to use two actions to investigate here. I'm going to grab my David Bucks before I forget, and then we will spend our two actions to investigate. We are going five versus three again. Chaos Bag gives us another minus one. So it seems that this game we're either drawing minus ones or tentacles. I prefer the minus ones, obviously. They are much easier to deal with. All right, so we've got our three clues. We can advance our Act 1A if we wish. We might as well. I don't think there's any reason not to in this particular scenario. Nothing terrible happens. So we will flip that over. Act 1B is the head janitor, so we shuffle the encounter discard pile and the set aside Jazz Mulligan into the encounter deck. Let's go find Jazz Mulligan. Where is he? There's Jazz right there. All right, so we've got Jazz Mulligan. Jazz Mulligan, of course, being the head janitor, we need to find him somewhere in the encounter deck. And while he is not controlled, we need to parlay with him and test three intellect. If successful, we get to take control of him. We do have our fine clothes to reduce the difficulty of that parlay test by two. The main reason I decided to pack the clothes in the first place. So we shuffle those into the encounter deck, and that will be our now advance to Act 2A, Rice's whereabouts. Now we can spend a clue to discard the top 10 cards of the encounter deck, and if we discard Jazz, we get to resolve his revelation effect and put him into play. Once we take control of Jazz, then we can advance to the next act. We will just shuffle that encounter deck one more time. So that was the investigation phase. Nothing happens during the enemy phase. And during upkeep, there's an unexpected courage. That is a very timely pull. Very, very nice. Now we can have a better odds, at least, of getting past this Yithian Observer. So what we want to do, I think, is go. Now my plan is to go Students' Union Building and then back over to the faculty offices, grab the clues there, and then we'll use the gate box to zip back over to Students' Union. And once we, and then we should be able to clear. Finish this scenario. All right, that's upkeep. Let's go on to Mythos. We have six of seven doom in play. And our encounter card is the Whippoorwills. They make their triumphant return. Whippoorwills, of course, being aloof, and they have two fight, one health, and four evade. Aloof and Hunter, and while they are at our location, our skills are our skill values are all minus one. We are not planning to stick around and hang out with the Whippoorwills. All right, we're gonna need I think we're gonna need all of our actions. Move, evade, move this turn. So we will move back to the Miskatonic Quad, which engages us with the Yithian Observer. We will use our next action to try to evade the Yithian Observer. We will use our unexpected courage to do so. We are 5 versus 3. Chaos Bag says another -1. Okay, well, -1s and tentacles so far. And one lily +1. So we do evade the Yithian. Good news there. And then we will move. My favorite character to play, Ben, is the character I'm playing at the time. It's really hard for me to pick a favorite because I tend to play them all. If I had to pick one, I really, really enjoy playing Zoe. I like her combination of fight, and I've had some very, very enjoyable campaigns playing her solo. Because she's got the combat, and I can just pack just enough investigate into her to get her through a lot of scenarios. So if I had to pick one, it would be definitely Zoe. That's the one I played at when we had some pickup games last year at Arkham Knights at the Fantasy Flight Center. I was playing Zoe in a group with, I believe it was Finn and Rex were the other two investigators. But yeah, Diana is the one I'm playing through the Circle Undone with. I will have more of those playthroughs coming up. I've just been tied up doing other things. I'm hoping to, I haven't played any of those scenarios, so they will be blind playthroughs with Diana. We do make it here to the Students' Union. It has the forced effect when Students' Union is revealed. We put the set-aside dormitories into play, and we can heal a damage and a horror there for an action. We haven't taken any damage or horror, so we don't have to worry about it. But we will put those into play. There are two clues here, which should be enough to get us control of Jazz Mulligan. Yeah, I haven't played as much Agnes lately, John. I think the last time I played her, I had a hell of a game with her against the Path to Carcosa in Curtain Call. I thought for sure I was going to lose that game, and somehow Agnes just pulled it out of the fire because she had ability to damage enemies really came in handy, and I was able to clear a lot of the locations and then make my way and finish the scenario. It was a great game, I don't know if another investigator would have been able to pull it off like Diana did. That was the investigation phase. Nothing in the enemy phase, and we go to upkeep, where we draw a copy of Deny Existence. That is from the Circle Undone. That helps us if we get attacked, largely. It will also help us if we take damage. I think this actually is excellent against Beyond the Veil. If we take damage, we won't take any damage. So that would be awesome. Yeah, I've been playing almost solely Mystic lately, so I probably will give Agnes a try with the new setup. I'm curious to see how she does. We are going to, I think we're advancing this turn. Yes, we are. So we will add a doom. We have 7 of 7, so we will remove our doom from David, and we will flip over our agenda. Agenda 1B is Something Stirs. Each investigator with 5 or more cards in his discard pile takes a horror. We have 3. Each investigator with 10 or more takes 2, so nothing happens. And if we have completed The House Always Wins, we advance directly, to 2B. Otherwise, we go to 2A. This is our first one, so we're at 2A. Agenda 2A is Dead of Night. Each investigator's maximum hand size is reduced by 3, so we can only have 5 cards in hand, and we need, it has a doom threshold of 3. So we need to draw an encounter card before I forget. There's another thrall. That is a pain because he is going to engage us. Now, that's not great because Thrall has two fight, two health and two evade. And it has retaliate, and we only have two combat. So trying to kill this guy without a weapon is not going to be easy. Okay, I think we're going to have to evade this chump. Let's get our actions first off. Yeah, I'm not sure if we're going to have enough time to get over to the faculty building and back. It might be tough to do that with the number of enemies and no weapon. All right, so we're going to have to evade this guy as our first action. So we're going 3 versus 2. Chaos Bag says another minus one. All right, well, we're being consistent at least. And so he is evaded. We want to grab these two clues as quickly as we can. So we are going before we do that. Now, do we need, I would prefer to have Renfield online, but we've only got 3 doom here. I think Renfield has, we need to swap him for the Holy Rosary at this point because the doom threshold on the next two agendas is so short that Renfield isn't going to really help us. All right, so we're just going to go 4 versus 1 this time with Sixth Sense. Chaos Bag gives us another tentacle. Ah, the Chaos Bag is being very consistent this morning. Nothing but minus ones and tentacles. All right, well, that's not going to help us, so we'll go 4 versus 1 again. There's a minus three. Thanks for dropping by, Ben. Check out the replay on YouTube when you get the chance. We do get a clue out of this, fortunately. All right. It is the upkeep phase. We get a drawn to the flame as our upkeep card. We seem to be having some connection difficulties here. Just going to wait a second, see if we can't pick it back up. Looks like Twitch is back on, so we'll see if we can't pick up YouTube as well. So the next set, the Dream Eaters, is going to be set in the Dreamlands. I'm really looking forward to seeing what this set has to offer and where we're going to go. The setting is so vast. There's so many different places that you can visit in that particular setting that there's just so many places to go. Selafay. Maybe meet King Karanes, Ulthar to hang out with the cats. Of course, there's going to be the Enchanted Forest and the Zoogs. That will be interesting with the swarm mechanic that is going to be coming in. I really hope that the swarm cards that we're adding to the Zoogs will only be one enemies with, say, one health. One fight, one evade, one health, and they only hit you for a damage and a horror. Although it could be more. I mean, they did a swarm mechanic in the other cooperative LCG, the Lord of the Rings card game, and the enemies that swarmed in that one were pretty beefy sometimes. Just waiting a second here to see if YouTube will come back. This is the first time I have been using Restream to try to stream to multiple platforms, and just waiting to see whether it is going to do the job or not. I'm not very impressed that it has dropped YouTube here temporarily. So we shall see. What else can we talk about? We've got the Gen Con scenario about the mighty blob that eats everything. We probably won't see that in print probably until sometime next year. That will be interesting, very pulpy sort of scenario. I haven't really had a chance to play many of the add-on scenarios as much as I would like. I've had a chance to play Guardians of the Abyss a few times, but I find that I tend to stick with the scenarios that are in the. You see me on YouTube? Okay, well, all right, well then let's continue. I can stop talking about random topics and we can get going here. All right, that was the upkeep phase. We did draw Drawn to the Flame. So we are engaged with the Thrall, and we will. I guess we'll go to the Mythos phase. And we add a Doom, and we will draw an encounter card, which is going to be Arcane Barrier. Attached to your location as an additional cost to move in or out of attached location, test for willpower. And if successful, discard Arcane Barrier. Otherwise, you must either cancel the effects of the move or discard the top five cards of your deck. Now, that's interesting. How does that interact with the gate box? Put it into play and move to it. So, yeah, the Arcane Barrier will interfere with our gate box move. So we will have to pass something there. Now we need a clue and we need to deal with this thrall. Unfortunately, we're not in a position to kill it. So we are just going to have to go and evade it and then keep on investigating. All right. We will try to evade 3 versus 2. Let's see, -1. No, a skull. But a skull is a -1, so same difference. So we do manage to evade the thrall. So we will use our second action to investigate. We are going to go 4 versus 1. We get a +1. Now we're seeing a little more variety. Now, the question is, how do we get away? If we trigger the gate box, we can. Oh, I forgot these guys. These guys have to move there and. Yeah, we'll just put them with us. I assume they are there. One, two, we drew one. Yeah, they should be here. So we are at -1. It didn't affect that investigation check, fortunately. Did it affect the. No, it wouldn't have affected the. Oh, maybe it would have. 3 versus 2. Yeah, it would have affected. Okay, so we've got to back up here a little bit. Stupid. I always forget about these damn birds. All right, so the birds are there. This guy is here. So our first shot at evading the thrall would not have succeeded because we were actually a 2 and we drew a -1. So this is going to be tough. The only way we can succeed is with a 0 or a 1. And we don't have any other icons. Now, maybe what we need to do. I think maybe getting out of here is what we need to do. If we trigger the gate box, we can get away from these guys. Go into our hidey hole. And then we could move. We'd have to go to the Ornn Library or here. Or to the Humanities Building. If we draw, if we get Jazz with one clue, we could do it. It's a free triggered ability, right? Okay, so we are going to use the Dream Gate. We're going to use the Dream Gate. Free triggered ability, we're going to get away from these chumps. Now we have to trigger the Arcane Barrier as well. This is getting complicated. Arcane Barrier, so we are a 4. We are actually a 3 versus 4, so it looks like we're going to have to discard some cards. Chaos Bag gives us a 0, so that is going to be a failure. Otherwise, we have to discard top 5 cards of our deck. There goes an Arcane Initiate. There goes our weakness. Renfield, Deny Existence, and Guts. Okay, so we've left the Students' Union Building behind. That was a free triggered ability. Now we can... I think what we're going to do is... We can use the Dream Gate. The Dream Gate's going to kick us out anyway if we stick around. So I am going to spend a couple resources to get our Holy Rosary down. So we're back up to 5 willpower. Do I have anything else to do? I can play Drawn to the Flame. It's connected to each other revealed location, so I could play Drawn to the Flame now. Is it worth doing it here, though? That's the question. Just for one clue. I guess it depends on whether we get Jazz or not. So what happens... That's interesting. So what happens if I was to trigger the action on Act 2A and discard 10 cards from the top of the encounter deck and I draw Jazz? Where does Jazz show up? Does he show up in the Dream Gate? At which point I get kicked out and he sticks there and I'm stuck? That's interesting. I am not sure about that. All right, well, we're going to get kicked out anyway for free. So we might as well... I don't think... it's an interesting question. Let's draw a card. There is our Wither. Okay. That's what we need. Okay, so we draw a Wither, and then at the end of the investigation phase, we set the Dream Gate aside, and we move him to any revealed location. So we'll just leave the Dream Gate there, and then we will bounce up here, I think. Now we've got a weapon that we can use, and we've got 5 willpower to use it, so we can kill some things if necessary. Now, the enemy phase, we need to remember to move our birds this time. And upkeep. Oh, that's interesting too. Storm of Spirits. Very interesting. We can actually Storm of Spirits, the Miskatonic Quad. That would kill the birds and the Ithian Observer would take two damage. Then we could move in. We wouldn't be able to kill him in one turn, though. But it sure would free up things. We need to get rid of some of these things in the. And actually, we can play the Storm of Spirits for free using our Uncage the Soul. Not that resources are an issue at the moment. Okay, so we've got a few different options that we can pursue going forward. We'll add a Doom. We're at 2 of 3. We actually need to discard a card. Which is going to be. I'm going to get rid of the sign magic because we have to stay. Our hand size is 3 smaller during the upkeep phase. All right. That's Mythos. So we need to draw a card. It's going to be another Thrall. Oh boy, oh boy. Look at all the thralls hanging out in the Students' Union building with the Arcane Barrier. Boy, a Storm of Spirits would go over well there as well. Of course, we could Storm of Spirits this location as well, and that would get rid of both of the thralls, and then we could move back in there. Grab that clue. However, we need to see if we get Jazz. That will determine what we do here. Let's see if we get Jazz first. So I'm going to spend the clue we have to discard the top 10 cards. All right, here we go. Arcane Barrier. Visions of Futures Past, Jazz. So that was 3, so we have to discard a whole bunch more. So we'll be at 9. Locked door. Oh, there goes the wizard. And an offer of power. Okay, Jazz shows up. All right, well, that worked out okay. Jazz will show up at our location. Now we can answer this question. What happens if Jazz. Put Jazz into play at your location. So he is not an enemy. So I think if Luke was to take the action on Act 2A while he's in the Dream Gate, Jazz would stay in the Dream Gate. You'd effectively trap him there, and then the only person who could get him would be Luke. Does that make sense? Man, that would be a grief play, wouldn't it? Hey, you could screw over your entire group. It's like, oh, I found Jazz and he's in my dream gate and I'm the only one he can get who can get him and I'm going to lock you out of the scenario. That seems to work. That's crazy. However, Jazz is not in the dream gate. He is here with us at the Orin Library. So we can take the action to parlay with him now to get him on our side. We've got our fine clothes out, so we're going to be that's going to be at -2. So we're going 3 versus 1 to grab Jazz. Chaos Bag gives us an Elder Sign. Hey, that's good. That's a +1, and we get to add something to the gate box. Place a charge on the gate box. Awesome. Okay. And we get Jazz. And now we advance the agenda. Since we've taken control of Jazz, we advance our act. We go to Act 2B. The experiment is loose. If the Alchemy Lab's location is not in play, put it into play. If you are on agenda 1 or 2, spawn the set-aside experiment at the Alchemy Labs. So we'll go get the Alchemy Labs. There's the experiment, and there is the alchemy labs. We will just tuck them over here because we're not planning to go up there. Okay. And then if you have completed, no, we have not. We don't worry about the alchemical concoction. We set it aside. So we simply advance to Act 3A, and our objective is to find and complete an objective on any other encounter card. So now we have a choice. We can either go for to save the students or to get Professor Rice. I don't think we can get both now. With the way we'd have to go through the quad, get to the faculty office. So that's going to be one, two actions. If we three actions, four actions, we'd have to get a thrall. Yeah, I don't think that's going to work. So we're just going to go and save the students, I think. We've got far too many enemies here on the table. We can try to get us, we could try to get us a victory point here. The birds are going to move to us. We could kill the Yithian Observer. That would, if we play our Withering, we're going to do that actually this turn as our final action. We'll play Wither. So we're okay for slots. We've used two arcane slots and that's it. All right. We can go to the Dream Gate and we can Storm of Spirits the Students' Union to clear out all those thralls. Then we could move there and then to the dormitories, and then it's just a matter of investigating. We could Storm of Spirits the Miskatonic Quad, killing, and then we could move in, kill the Yithian Observer, but then we still have to go through. We don't have a shriveling at the moment, so we'd have to kill these two thralls. That'd take four actions with Wither. That's not great. I think we'll just go and save the students. I think it's going to be a little too much to get over to the faculty offices. So we go to the enemy phase and the birds will move. And we will go to upkeep. There's a guts. All right, and so we put our third doom on agenda 2A, so we will advance. We are advancing to agenda 2B, the experiment gone wrong. If dormitories is not in play, put it into play. If the experiment is in play, move it one location toward the dormitories. So it is at the science building. And if it is not in play, we put it at the science building. We advance to agenda 3A, the beast unleashed. When this agenda would advance by reaching its doom threshold, instead remove all doom in play and move the experiment one location toward the dormitories. If the experiment enters the dormitories, we advance. All right. Well, we need to draw an encounter card. Let's do that. We get Eager for Death, test 2 willpower. Increase this skill test difficulty by 1 for each damage on you. If you fail, you take 2 horror. We've got plenty of sanity. But we are only a 4 due to those stupid birds. So we are a 4 versus 2. Chaos Bag says minus 1. Ah, there we go. Back on track, Chaos Bag. Back on track after that crazy minus 3 and an Elder Sign. So Eager for Death just doesn't do a whole lot. I think there's only been one game I've ever played where Eager for Death has been a real threat at any time. So now we are going to use our hidey hole. Let's use our pocket dimension. We'll gate box in as a free action. Now the gate box, the dream gate is connected to each other revealed location. So we are connected to the Students Union building. I'm gonna play Uncage the Soul to play our Storm of Spirits for free. I don't have to, I've got tons of resources, but might as well use it for something. That is going to give us, we are going 5 versus 1. 5 versus 2, sorry, the thralls are 2. So we're just gonna target one of the thralls. So we're going 5 versus 2. I think this is going to be basically the end of the game. During, I'm gonna trigger David during one of the player windows during the combat. We'll add a doom to him to give us another one. So we're up to 6. And then we will 6 versus 2. Chaos Bag gives us another -1. So we wipe out the thralls with the Storm of Spirits. Now we can move over, because the Dream Gate is connected to revealed locations, we can move into the Students Union building. Now we need to deal with the Arcane Barrier as well, but now we are a 6 willpower versus 4. We might as well use a guts here just to deal with that. That will give us plenty of, we get a +1 anyway. We didn't need that, but we get a card. There's a ward of protection. The Arcane Barrier disappears. Crazy Gamer, this is Luke Robinson. He is the new Mystic Investigator who was spoiled for the Dream Eaters by Fantasy Flight Games, the next deluxe expansion. They spoiled him, I believe it was last Monday, not this Monday, but the previous Monday. So he's been, FFG spoiled his Investigator card as well as his signature asset, the Gate Box. And he uses his gate box allows him to pop into a pocket dimension called the Dream Gate. And there are 2 copies of the Dream Gate. One is the Wondrous Journey, which is the good Dream Gate, where he is basically connected to all locations. And then the bad Dream Gate is basically locks him out of everything and he can't do anything. And Luke Robinson's special ability allows him to play one event as if he was at a connecting location. So that's why I was able to be at the Dream Gate and Storm of Spirits, this particular location, the Students Union building. I am going to move as my final action to the dormitories and flip that over. Since we've got Jazz to open the door for us, it's a one shroud location with 3 clues. So all we need to do now is grab our 3 clues and we will be done. So far the gate box dream gate combination does have its limits. If you have no revealed locations on the table, it can be a real it doesn't help Luke, and so Luke has to rely on his agility and combat and whatnot. I'm not sure what the relationship is between the Dream Gate and the Hemispheric Map. I'm just checking to see here. Basically, I think the Dream Gate is set aside out of play. So I think as long as it is in play, I'd have to look at what I'm curious now what hemispheric map does. Can't remember offhand. It's the one where if you're attached to more locations, you get bonuses, right? While your current location is connected to at least two other locations, you get +1/+1 willpower. Potentially, Luke could hide out in the Dream Gate and give himself +2 willpower and +2 intellect. Of course, that will go away the moment he leaves. As long as, say, the Dream Gate is connected to four other locations, you get +2 willpower and +2 intellect. But it wouldn't help him though if he was in the pointless reality Dream Gate, because the hemispheric map needs to be connected to locations, and the pointless reality isn't connected to any locations. So the hemispheric map would not help Luke with that investigation check. Well, I'm still working through the Circle Undone cycle as well, Crazy Gamer. But when I saw Luke, I was eager to give him a try. And there's some good things and some not so good things so far. I'd say his movement ability. No, enemies can't go to the Dream Gate, so he's safe. And he disengages from enemies when he moves to the Dream Gate, so he's safe there. The problem is you need revealed locations. So if there are no revealed locations, you can't escape to the Dream Gate. And the other issue is there aren't a lot of mystic events right now that allow you to target other locations really effectively. Like, there's things like Blinding Light, but Blinding Light isn't that good. I'd say Drawn to the Flame and Storm of Spirits are probably your best bets. So hopefully we'll see a few more cards. I know there's at least one that's been spoiled, that being the Open Gate card that was spoiled in the article, but I'm not playing it in this particular deck because it's not clear from that... From that preview article, how many copies of Open Gate you can put in your deck. I think that was... So we're still... that was our investigation phase. The enemies we need to move are Whippoorwills. And we go to upkeep, and we draw our Prophecy. Open Gate will be amazing in four player. If you can get two gates down at the right locations, that will you could ferry, you know, every other player around the board quite easily. We draw a Prophecy that isn't going to really help us this game. So that was upkeep. We do have. So we add a Doom. And we will draw an encounter card. That is going to be Terror from Beyond. I haven't seen this one in a while. Peril, choose one of the following asset, event, or skill. We have to discard cards in our hands that is of the chosen card type. Asset. I'll choose asset. Okay, so no big deal there. Or we could have chosen skill. Yeah, either way, I don't think it matters. We're not gonna lose our we'd lose our prophecy if we chose skill, but we don't have any assets, so it's no big deal. All right, we've got three actions. We can finish this off now. We just need to complete this objective and grab three clues, which we do have this Drawn to the Flame, so we might as well play it. So we will... Now, is there any advantage to playing it in the... Nah, there is none. So we will play Drawn to the Flame. We'll draw another encounter card. There's a Whippoorwills. No big deal. So we are going to be -1 willpower when we investigate, but we do get the two clues. And... That will be that. We have one action, so we will go five versus one for the final clue. We get a skull, that's a minus one. All right. So not a great game from a victory point perspective. I think we end up with two. I can't remember whether we get any for saving the students. So we only get two from the table. We didn't kill the Yithian Observer, but we didn't draw our Wither until very late in the game. The Dreamgate did come in handy in this game because it did allow us to, one, escape from the Students' Union building and then flee up to Orin Lyberg and then pop back to the Dreamgate and Storm of Spirits, the lot of them. So that was good. It didn't really help us at the beginning of the game when we were stuck at Miskatonic Quad and we were stuck with this Yithian Observer and we wanted to get away from it. Drawing three tentacles near the beginning of the game didn't help us either. That really slowed us down. I was hoping to be able to get over to the faculty offices and then back to the dormitories, but unfortunately, we were not able to do that this game. So, yeah, so far I have to say, like Drawn to the Flame and Storm of Spirits are our best cards to play from the Dreamgate. We don't have a lot of other ones that are going to be able to play there. Deny Existence and Ward of Protection and stuff like that. We can't really leverage them from the Dreamgate. So I'm looking forward to seeing more cards. Of course, we've got Open Gate coming out with the Dream Eater cycle. That will really help because you can basically what you can do with Luke in that scenario, if you've got two Open Gates in your hand, you could play an Open Gate on a location, pop into your pocket dimension, play, and then use the because Open Gate is fast, then you could play another copy of Open Gate, and basically you have two Open Gates on the table, and then you can ferry everybody around as necessary. So that is our first game of with Luke Robinson. I'm gonna load up another game. I'm not sure if anybody in the chat has a preference. I can play pretty much any of the opening scenarios that we want. I'm thinking of playing Path to Curtain Call, so that's what I was going to do, but if you have a preference for something else, just let me know in the chat. We could do Return to the Gathering or Forgotten Age as well. I don't think Return to the Gathering would be a particularly good show of Dreamgate just because I think the only real time you could use it would be as if you were far above or far below your house to get back to the hallway at the end of your turn. Although I think you do reveal the parlor, which creates some interesting options there. You could move to the parlor and grab Lita Chandler there as well. Let's see here. So we'll reset. And we will load up. Where am I here? Desktop. Yeah, I have to build decks on another computer and transfer them to this computer because of there's some sort of weird bug in Octagon that won't let me change the tokens in the chaos bag. All right. Luke 2. We've got our Dreamgate and let's load up Path to Carcosa. I haven't played Curtain Call in a while. One of my favorite scenarios. Could be tough with the Royal Emissary. He could be really tough to deal with, but he's tough for any solo investigator to deal with when you have to keep him off the table. We do have Wither, but we will need a Shriveling to deal with him. He's got 4 fight. That's pretty tough. Although, you know, Luke does have 9 sanity, so we could simply sit there and just soak the sanity from him if necessary. So we shall see. All right, there's our map. Nice and small. We will throw Luke in the theater. So what are potential issues Luke could face in this particular scenario? There are the whispers in your head. I believe one prevents you from triggering free triggered abilities. That would suck because that would lock him out of his gate box. There's also, I believe, one that prevents you from playing events. That also would hamper us. So those are the two that I think we would need to take the actions in order to cancel them. Obviously, there are quite a few enemies in this particular scenario. Not worried about the rats. The rats are easy enough to deal with. It's the Servant of the Yellow King and those crazy... the crazy guys who steal clues, they might be an issue as well. We will shuffle up our deck here, and let's draw another random weakness. I always like to see what we get. We're going to play with internal injury this time. Ooh, that's bad news for Luke, having only 5 health. So that will be definitely taking the 2 actions to get rid of that as quickly as possible. This particular scenario is hard on your sanity. Luke shouldn't have too much trouble with that. All right, let's draw our opening hand and see how we do here. All right, we got a Sign Magic, a David Renfield, a Shriveling, an Internal Injury, and a Deny Existence. So we get to mulligan the Internal Injury. We get another Shriveling. Wow. It's pretty good. Both Shrivelings. Do we keep the Sign Magic and the Deny Existence? Can't remember what the shroud value. The shroud values on this can be pretty severe. So I think we want to investigate. Yeah, we're going to have to commit these. We'll have to mulligan these. Keeping both Shrivelings because there's another Sign Magic and a Word of Protection. So no Sixth Sense. And no Arcane Initiate in order to draw it. So maybe we don't need David so much in this deck as the Arcane Initiate might be better because we need to draw that Sixth Sense as early as we can. So we have some ability in order to investigate. Very well. We are good to go here. David is going to speed this game up, but maybe we can use him if we speed it up. The thing with this scenario is you've got to take, unless you're absolutely positive that you can race it and beat it before the Royal Emissary becomes an issue, you're better off playing it slow. So I think I am going to just bring out David and get some resources and get our Shrivelings down on the table. Then we'll kill the Royal Emissary the first time he shows up, and then I think from there we will try to beat it. So we get David on the table, we will grab our David bucks, and we will get another willpower. So we're up to 5. Let's see, we are going, that was our first action, second action. Let's get our copy of Shriveling down. All right, so we've got a Shriveling down. So we've got a little protection from enemies. And then we will move to backstage. Backstage is a three shroud location with one clue, and when we reveal it, we put the two set aside back two of the set aside back to backstage doorway locations into play at random. So we will do that now. There they are. There is one, there's a lobby, another lobby, and a backstage. So here are our two backstage doorway locations. And that will be our, yes, Silverthorn, welcome. I am playing the new guy today, giving him a try. So far, so good, I guess. He's been all right. Not a stellar game of extracurricular activity, but we didn't die, so I guess that's something. That will be our turn, I think. So we go to upkeep. We draw another copy of David Renfield. That's not going to be all that helpful for the time being. I guess it is an ally we can sacrifice in case we do need to do some running, but we shouldn't have to do that just because we do have our gate box to move us around if necessary. All right, let's add a doom. We are at 2 of 6, and our encounter card is going to be a Rotting Remains. So this is just a straight 5 versus 3 check. Chaos Bag gives us an Elder Sign, so that's a +1, and we get to add a token to the gate box. So off to a flying start there. All right. Don't mind that. We do not have a way to grab this clue very easily, so we're just going to have to do some investigating. Maybe we'll grab that clue later. Let's go check out the... let's go check out what's backstage. All right, backstage rehearsal room, one shroud location with one clue, and after you succeed by 2 or more while investigating the rehearsal room, take a horror. We are a 3 versus 1. I don't think we're going to succeed by 2 or more, but let's see. -1, so we only succeed by 1, so we don't take a horror, but we do get the clue. All right. We've got 1 action remaining. We will pop, move, and yeah, we'll just pop back here. So far, so good. That's another turn in the bag. No enemies to worry about. We draw another Ward of Protection. Forgot to grab my David Bucks that turn, so that's need to remember that. And we will add a doom, so we are at 3 of 6. And we are going to draw. There is our first swarm of rats. Our first swarm of rats comes down. So we have a 2 combat, not fantastic, but I'm not going to waste a shriveling charge on killing rats, that's for sure, when we've got the Royal Emissary going to be here shortly. So we will take an action to try to kill the rats. We get a -1, that's good enough, the rats will die. Second action, we will move to this backstage doorway. We're going to get some more. No. There we go. Second backstage doorway is the trap room, 3 shroud location with 1 clue. After you reveal the trap room, search the encounter deck and discard pile for a swarm of rats and put it into play engaged with you 2 copies instead if there are 3 or 4 investigators. Let's go find some more rats. We'll just grab this rats that's already in the discard pile. And we will take another action to kill them. Chaos Bag says, Skull, that is a -1/-3 instead if you've got 3 or more horror. So we show up at the trap room and bash some more rats. I'm going to get my David Bucks this turn. And that will be my investigation phase. No enemies to worry about. There's our 6th sense, just in time. Good to see that. Okay, so now we've got the Shriveling and the 6th Sense. I don't think we're going to need Sign Magic this game. I don't think we're going to need the extra hands or the extra Arcane slot. All right. Let's go to the Mythos phase. Three, four of six, and we draw another Rotting Remains. So we're going five versus three again. Chaos Bag gives us a minus one, so we are fine there. So far, so good. Get our three actions. We will want to play our Sixth Sense now. First, I'm going to get my David Bucks. I'm going to play my Sixth Sense as my first action. So that gets us, that gives us some way of investigating. I will investigate as our second action. So we're going five versus three. Chaos Bag gives us a minus two, so we grab this clue. And then we will move to the backstage. And that'll be our turn. We draw Prophecy. Boy, that would be sweet to play now. That's a triple icon card right now. Triple wild icons, that's awfully nice. But we are at five of six, so the Royal Emissary is about to make his appearance. Let's draw an encounter card. There is a Poltergeist. Okay. Poltergeist, 3 fight, 2 health, 4 evade. Monster Geist cannot be damaged except by spells, relics, or encounter cards. Parlay, test 3, intellect to attempt to banish the Geist. If you succeed, deal it 1 damage. We do not need to to do that. We can kill it, hopefully with one shot from shriveling. So that is what we will do first. We will shrivel it. So we are going five versus three, and we draw a zero, so this takes 2 damage and dies. Now we need to grab this clue. So we will investigate five versus three with Sixth Sense. We get a minus two again, so we grab that clue, and now we can advance. We can advance to the next act. So we will spend our clues. All right, so we choose a set aside, one of the set aside locations at random and put that location into play and spawn the set aside man in the Pallid Mask enemy at that location instead of his normal spawn location. And then we advance to one of the three copies of Act 2A. So we will, let's see where, let's hide these so we're not cheating. We'll shuffle them up, and the man in the Pallid Mask is going to be at the lobby doorway. He's going to be over here. Okay. So, yeah, we're not going to have to move too much here. And then we need to advance to one of these at random. So I'm going to pull them all out, shuffle them up. We're going to go to this one. And I think we're ready to go. All right, so this, of course, is when the man in the Pallid Mask would be discarded from play, we get to advance. All right, so we're going to the Royal Emissary is going to show up this turn. We can move to the theater and just wait for him, kill him there. We want our David money, though. That's important. Or the other option is we could move back to one of these. We could move to the rehearsal room or the trap room. Hide there. Let the emissary come after us. Yeah, but then we won't have enough time, I don't think, to get. Yeah, we're going to have to kill the emissary. So we'll move there and wait for him. And that'll be our turn. We draw an arcane initiate. Okay, so we could sacrifice David now, if necessary. I'm not sure why, like, the arcane initiate isn't gonna... gives us a couple horror to do, to sanity to soak. David, but David gives us the plus one willpower, which is all important. All right, so that is gonna be our upkeep phase. 6 of 6 doom, so we lose our doom on David. And we flip this over. We go to agenda 1B, the emissary's message. Search all set aside cards and victory display for the royal emissary and spawn it in the theater. So it is here. And we will have to fight it. We move to agenda 2A, encore. After the royal emissary is added to the victory display, remove all doom from play and reset the agenda deck to agenda 1A, then place 3 doom on that agenda. Okay, so we still need to draw an encounter card, which is going to be the Twisted to His Will. If there is no doom in play, Twisted to His Will gains surge. It will surge. There is a fanatic. Revealed location with the most clues. Well, that's pretty easy. There are no clues on the table. He can hide up here. So one enemy we do not have to deal with. We get our 3 actions. We need to kill the royal emissary as our first order of business. We need to trigger David Renfield as a free action to gain a resource and boost our willpower back up to 5. So we're going 5 versus 4, and he's got retaliate. I don't think we're going to use our sign magic this game, so we're going to go 6 versus 4. That should be enough. We haven't taken any horror. Let's see what the chaos bag has to say about that. It's a skull. That's a -1. So he will take 2 damage. We will take a horror because of the skull. Whoops. And we have to do that one more time. Let's commit... Now, Prophecy is going to be really good next turn, as soon as we kill the Royal Emissary. So we don't want to commit that. We're not going to use the Arcane Initiate, I don't think. So we're going to go again 6 versus 4. Chaos Bag gives us a 0, so that's 1 dead Emissary. Okay, and we reset. I have to go find our, where did it go? So the third act comes back into play. Remove all doom from play. So we lose our doom on David Renfield. That's okay. That is all right. He did his job. We put that into play and then we place 3 doom on it. So we have reset to agenda 1A. Now we can move again to... Oh, we spent another shriveling charge. All right. So we are going to move to the lobby. Lobby is a 4 shroud location with 1 clue, and when it is revealed, we put the 2 set aside lobby doorway locations, and we can take a double action to draw 2 cards. Or is it three cards? Two cards? Three cards. There should only be a couple of lobby doorways here. There's only one we care about, though, because that's where the man in the pallid mask is. And that will be our turn again. So we will go to... I guess we're going to upkeep. We draw an unexpected courage. Okay, so this is good. We've got prophecy, which is three wild icons and an unexpected courage for another two. So that we've got five wild icons, seven if you include the two wards of protection in our hand. And we've got an extra David for an intellect. So we might actually, we could investigate the man in the pallid mask if this shroud value isn't too bad. We have a ton of icons if we need them. And then we could kill him next turn when he pops back to the lobby. I do like the gate box. The gate box dream gate here is going to help us avoid all that nastiness that once you kill the once the man in the pallid mask is discarded for the first time, you have all those nasty walking locations. We're not going to really have to worry about that too much, but say if we were over here at the rehearsal hall and we had to deal with the man in the pallid mask there, we get one of those nasty acts that requires you to move through all that. Move through the fire or the flood or the ooze making agility skill tests, we just get to bypass all that. We wouldn't have to deal with it at all thanks to the gate box. So that's pretty good. We have done upkeep, so we are going to go to Mythos. Four of six. We draw Spires of Carcosa. Oh no. That's not great. That is not great. Spires of Carcosa being, of course, attached to your location, then we place two doom on it. So the lobby now has two doom on it as well, which will advance us next turn. And if there is no doom on the spires, then we remove all the doom. And we discard it. That's going to advance us. I don't think it's worth our time trying to... We're basically waste an entire turn trying to deal with the spires. I think we're better off just going after the... Crazy Gamer, the Dream Gate, if you're in the Dream Gate, you can be affected by encounter cards. It's just, oh, that's right. Thanks, John. I forgot about, I do have ward. Yes, you are correct. That is a ward. That is a ward if I ever saw one. Thank you very much. All right, so we do, we'll just ward the spires. That will get rid of that issue, and we keep our momentum going. Great thought there, John. Thank you very much. All right, so that saves us a ton of problems. Now we just move into this lobby location. It is the box office. Hey, it's a two shroud location. Look at that. I don't think the spreading stuff at the end affects the Dream Gate. That's a good question, Crazy Gamer. Dream Gate. Well, the thing is, the Dream Gate is actually out of play most of the game. It's only in play if Luke is at it. So I don't think the I'm pretty sure the spreading ooze and fire and floods do not affect the Dreamgate because it won't be in play most of the game. I've just put it next to Luke here just to show, just so I remember that I have it. But if you were playing, say, with real cards, it would just be out of play and you would only go there when you had the when you used the gate box. So yeah, not it's not something that you would have to worry about typically. Okay, well, we've got one action. We've got two actions left. So what we can do is we can try to investigate. And we might as well investigate. We've got two. We'll take the investigate action on the man. We can go. This is going to be a bit of a risk, but we're going to commit the prophecy and the unexpected courage. That will put us at. This will be at a four, so we will be two, three, four, five, six, seven versus four. That's a minus three. I'm awfully tempted to commit that other ward of protection. Yeah, let's do that. I think that trumps the chaos bag. We go, it's four, and we are two, five, six, seven, eight. So we're good to minus four, and we get a minus two. So we investigate our location, and the man in the pallid mask is placed out of play. So now we trigger the end game. The stranger, when the man in the pallid mask would be discarded from play, we advance. So we flip this over. It is. The path is mine. Instead of discarding the man in the pallid mask, move him to the lobby. So he is in the lobby. And then, well, what do we do here? Add two tablets to the bag. So we will do that now. Just throw one of those in there. We'll add two tablets. Shuffle those up. So this one is the place one horror on the location the man in the pallid mask was moved from. Until the end of the scenario, horror on locations represent the advancing ooze, and each location with horror gains forced. After you leave this location, test four agility. If you fail, take one damage and one horror. Keep this card next to the act deck as a reminder. Now, I believe that we will, because we do have to, if we use our gate box to move, we will still have to test that for agility, so because of the ooze. So what we can do, we can burn a use our gate box as a free action to zip to our pocket dimension, the Dream Gate, and then we can hide in the Dream Gate, or we can use it since it's connected to every revealed location. We can now move from the Dream Gate to the lobby. Yeah, it doesn't, using the Dream Gate here doesn't really help us, does it? Because we just move anyway. We have to make an agility four test. There's a tablet that is a minus four, and if your location has at least one horror on it, take one horror. Okay, so we're going to take two damage. We're going to take a damage and two horror out of that. And then we will move. We're going to get kicked out anyway. So I am going to, we don't need sixth sense anymore. So I'm going to hide in the, I'm going to hide and I'm going to play my other copy of Shriveling to replace. the Sixth Sense. I don't need it anymore. And then at the end of the turn, we get kicked out of the Dream Gate and we move to the lobby. So next turn, we can engage the man in the pallid mask, shriveling, hopefully defeat him. That's the plan. Okay. That was investigation. Enemy phase, nothing happens. Oh, we draw internal injury. So we draw our weakness. Yeah, that's fine. That's not great. Never great to draw your weakness, but we do still have 4 health and we don't have to do any more moving. The man in the pallid mask doesn't hit us for health. He just hits us for horror. So as long as we can try to shrivel twice, we can beat him. All right, we're at 5 of 6. We will draw an encounter card. It is the King's Edict. For each cultist enemy in play, move 1 clue from that enemy's location to that enemy. There are no cultists. No, there's 1 cultist, but there are no clues there. So until the end of the round, each cultist enemy gets +1 fight for each clue and or doom on it. If no clues, it surges. Whoops, shouldn't have done that. Okay. We need to draw them. Oh no. We surge into the Agent of the King. Brutal. Well, crap. Okay, so now we're going to have to kill the Agent of the King and the Royal Emissary again, I think. We're going to get a victory point. But, yeah, not great. And he's tough, too. Doesn't have retaliate, though. We could evade him. He's worth a victory point, though. So, okay, let me think about this for a second. So if we kill him this turn, with any luck, we can engage the man in the pallid mask, but then we're going to get the Royal Emissary. So we'd have to kill the Royal Emissary, reset, and then... Okay, so we don't need to engage the man this turn. We kill the agent, we draw a card, then we wait for the emissary to come back, we kill him, then we kill the man. So we're gonna have to play it a little slower than I was hoping. We can't just go after the man quite yet. I've played this too many times with Mystics and I've run out of shriveling charges, a crazy gamer, and just end up in a world of hurt, being unable to kill anything. This internal injury is really badly timed. That is really difficult to deal with. I'm wondering if I don't try to evade the Agent of the King, but I still need 2 actions to get rid of this. Four turns, though. So 1 turn to take care of the agent. He comes back. 1 turn to take care of the king. I will have to get rid of the... I've got... Well, Yeah, I've got David as well. Okay, so I can soak a damage with David for a turn. All right, not unwinnable yet. So yeah, this is our investigation phase. So we are going to have to try to kill the agent of the king. Not leaving ourselves a whole lot of room for error here. We have just enough shriveling charges to defeat everything. Before I do that, I need to power up with David to get us back up to five. Yeah, five versus four, not great. We're gonna need a little bit of luck here to get through this. And the chaos bag is definitely not favorable now because the skulls are minus threes and the tablets are minus fours. Actually, we also needed to deal with this, I should remember, because that will impact us if we draw a skull, or sorry, a tablet. Yeah, Dreamgate double action move far away doesn't really help us because we need to. Oh, he is a hunter. Yeah, if we Dreamgate move far away. That's actually a pretty good plan, Crazy Dreamer. Or sorry, Crazy Dreamer, Crazy Gamer. 'Cause the guy will hunt us. We can pull him away from them. Yeah, that might be a better. We're not going to get victory points, but we can beat this scenario if we pull them all away from us and then Dreamgate back. Yeah, that's probably a much better play. Okay, so we will Dreamgate. So he gets we move here. We double action to get rid of the internal injury. And then we skedaddle. We've got a card draw we can do. There's a rosary. Okay, that's very helpful. We need that. I'm going to play the rosary. And that boosts our willpower to six. At the end of the investigation phase, we get dumped into the trap room. During the enemy phase, the agent will chase us. Agent gives chase, and then we get a drawn to the flame. Yeah, so we've moved away. Now we can pull the two enemies away from the man in the pallid mask and hopefully kill him. And then we can win this. Tricky, but yeah, good plan, crazy gamer. That's upkeep. So we go to Mythos. So we advance. So again, we lose our David. That flips, and we pull the Royal Emissary back. Okay. So we pull him back into play. Now we're going to have to. Oh. Okay, there's a pra. Yeah. Okay, so what we had to do here, there's something I forgot. So that goes there. And then we did another Mythos phase. So those go there, and that goes there, and there. So we would have to take a damage. We'd have to test for take a horror and a damage from the ooze after we left the lobby. So we'll test that. Get a zero. We still fail. So we take a damage and a horror. So we will... Yeah, we should be okay. We can have the ooze spread to the backstage, and then we can zip back. Okay. Where do we stand here? Okay, we need to draw an encounter card. And we get Dissonant Voices, no events or assets this turn. Okay, so we know that. I'm going to trigger David to get us more resources and boost us back up to six. I am going to, now I could draw, I could simply just draw three cards. What happens if I pull my weakness? If I pull my weakness, I get pushed into the pointless reality. Which would give me two more horror. That's okay. I'm going to draw some cards. First card, we get Deny Existence. Okay, that's good. That will protect us from damage or horror. Second card is going to be an Unexpected Courage. That is also good. I think I'm going to... Well, if we get Pointless Realityed, missing a turn now wouldn't be the worst thing in the world. Let's draw another card. There's another Prophecy. Okay, so that's good. Maybe. If we draw this game out enough, the Prophecy will have three wild icons. Okay, so we go to the enemy phase. The Royal Emissary and the Agent of the King chase us. We go to the end of the turn. We draw Guts, so we've got plenty of fodder for shriveling now. We've got icons up the wazoo. When does this... At the end of the enemy phase, investigators at the connecting location take a horror. So we have to take another horror. We can put that on our Holy Rosary. Okay. And then these spread. Where is this? Where am I reading the spreading from? Yeah, place one horror on a location with no horror connected. Okay, so this gets a horror now. And, all right. Yeah, Dynamite. I don't think... I don't think Luke Robinson is going to be able to take Dynamite. That would be pretty cool if he could play that from his Dreamgate. Pop into his pocket dimension and then throw some dynamite out of it and just blow everything else up. He does have Storm of Spirits, but we just haven't seen that card yet. That's not going to really help us against two four health enemies, however. There have been games, though, where I've been able to play double Storm of Spirits, which would deal with these two clowns, but unfortunately we can't deal with them at the moment. So we have... I think we lost our Doom... No, we're okay. We add a Doom and we draw an encounter card. Whispers in your head, dread. Okay. Peril hidden, secretly add it to your hand. You cannot move more than once each turn. Okay, that kind of throws us in a bit of a loop here, doesn't it? Okay, so how does this work? If I move, I assume the forced effect on the Dream Gate would override the cannot move. On because whispers in my head only lets me move once per turn, but the Dream Gate, if I move to the Dream Gate would have to kick me out, so tech and move me, so technically I'm moving twice. That's yeah, I'm not sure how those two cards interact, because if I move to the Dream Gate, it's the forced effect on the Dream Gate that's kicking me out. So I'm not technically moving myself, I'm being moved by something else. So I assume that, I mean, it wouldn't make any sense otherwise, that I'd have to be moved. So that's the way we'll play it. So we'll just take our three actions. So what we're going to do is, I can't move from the Dream Gate myself. I have to let the Dream Gate do the move for me, I think is what happens here. This is a very strange, interaction. But I mean, With the card pool growing to the size that it is, I think you're bound to find some of these weird interactions that that don't make a whole lot of sense. So I will move to the Dream Gate, and I will hide in the Dream Gate. Now, do I need to take any actions? I don't really have anything I want to do, and I don't want to draw any cards lest I take another couple horror from being, I'm already going to take one from the Royal Emissary. So I'm just going to pass my two actions. I am going to, so then at the end of my turn, the Dream Gate goes out of play and kicks me out to the lobby. During the enemy phase, these two goons move over and I take another horror from the emissary. Then we go to upkeep. We draw another guts. Okay, so we've got more than enough. Yeah, I know it says cannot, and typically cannot move overrides everything else, but the forced effect on the Dream Gate has to trigger. So I don't know how you reconcile the two, because the Dream Gate is being placed out of play, and it says if Luke Robinson is here, move him to any revealed location, and he takes the end of the investigation phase, set Dream Gate aside out of play. If Luke Robinson is here, move him to any revealed location. So the cannot should override that, but the forced effect means the Dream Gate disappears and then Luke is left in limbo. Like, I've only moved once per turn with Luke. It's technically the Dream Gate that's moving me because it's vanishing. That's what I don't understand. That might be worth asking Matt Newman about what the deal is with that. So yeah, that's a strange. Well, we're in the end game here. We've got three of six doom. We have to draw an encounter card. We get another Twisted to His Will. If there is no doom in play, it gains surge. Otherwise, it's X, where X is the amount of doom in play. It's going to be 3. So we are 6 versus 3. I'm fine with that. We draw -4, of course. So we're going to have to discard two cards from our hand at random, but we have deny existence, so we can deny that. We can deny that. All right. I think this is going to be the last turn. We're either going to win it or lose it here, so let's just deal with it. We will... Oh, we can't win. Oh, because we need a turn to resign. Shoot. No, we're still okay. We're still okay. We engage with the man in the pallid mask. We're going to take another damage and horror, though. Okay, so we engage him. We need to move. We're going to have to move and then Dreamgate back to resign. Because it's an action. Doesn't matter where we go. If we move to the balcony... No, we don't want clues on the table because then we get the fanatic. Shoot, I'm going to take... I'm going to take two horror. Boy, this is... Oh, this is not good. I think we can still win, but it's going to be very close because we've got to move. So we move here. We take an attack of opportunity from the man in the pallid mask. So we take a horror. So we'll put that on... the rosary. We also need to take, because of the ooze, we need to test four. We get an elder sign. Wow, we passed that. Unbelievable. That is super lucky. So we pass the test of, we get 4/4, so we don't take another damage in a horror. Oh, wow, that's close. Okay, then we have to shoot the man in the pallid mask once. Man, I wish I had extra damage to deal him. So we are going... We'll shrivel. Guts. Don't know if I want a guts. I don't want to draw a card. I've only moved once per turn because of this. Oh, shoot. That whispers in my head is going to kill me. Because, again, I'm going to move to my gate. I'm going to get dumped into this location, and then I'm going to have to fight everybody. Yeah, I don't think I can win this. I can kill the man, but I can't. I probably can't resign. Maybe. Okay, let's just hit that. I don't think I need to use the gate, actually. So that may be the thing that saves me. We are going... Our willpower is 5. So we are 5, 6, 7 versus 4. 8 versus 4. That takes the tablets and the skulls out. Oh my, come on, game. Oh, you SOB. Well, that was that. We did everything. Yes, again, we did everything right. We played the best we could, and then we just draw a tentacle at the end, and so it just hoses us. Oh, that is disappointing. Yes, this happened exactly the same as last time. I would have preferred a tentacle any other time. I trump the chaos bag, and then it gives me another tentacle. So now I can't beat it. Oh, that is disappointing. So now I take another horror. So I can take this one. During the enemy phase. These two move, and I take another horror. I can't win now because I just don't have enough sanity. I needed to hit him that. If I had hit the man in the pallid mask that turn, I could have won because I could have hit him again next turn, then moved, then resigned, and I would have been fine. Oh, and I took another horror because of the shriveling. So yeah, okay, yeah, I am definitely dead there. Because I'd have to discard... David, sorry. Oh, that's disappointing. That's disappointing, but that's what happens in this game sometimes. You end up drawing a tentacle and at just the wrong time, and it ends up costing you the game. So we had a chance. We had a chance to win. Unfortunately, we just ended up pulling the tentacle at just the wrong time. We had the chaos bag beat, and we would have had it beat because we had guts. We had two copies of guts and a prophecy in our hand. We could have easily trumped the chaos bag a second time. Let's see if we would have drawn anything for guts. No, we would have drawn another Uncage the Soul, which is another, you know, more willpower icons. So, oh, that pisses me off. That pisses me off. However, so this game, we did get to see the gate box in action, and it did give us a fighting chance in order to get to an end game. That was a great idea to bounce to a different location, pull all those enemies away, and then bounce back. You couldn't do that with another investigator, barring having two copies of, say, something like Astral Travel in your hand, or maybe two copies of Elusive. So that is definitely a powerful effect. We've already seen one sort of strange interaction with the gate box and whispers in your head. I'm not too sure how, not the gate box, but the... Yes, Elusive is the other one that you could do it with. Dreamgate and whispers in your head creates a strange interaction that I'm not entirely sure how that is supposed to be resolved. I would assume that the forced effect on the Dreamgate overrides whispers in your head and simply tosses you into another location, but we'd probably have to get a ruling from Matt Newman on whether that is in fact the case. So that, I think, is going to do it for this stream. Just a couple of things before everybody runs off. If you haven't done so already, make sure you visit my Facebook page at the Whisperer in Darkness channel and like that page, and I'll be posting notifications of future streams. I'm hoping to stream much more regularly going forward. I'm probably going to stream again on Friday if you want to get in on that one. If there is anything you would like to watch me stream, please head over to my Facebook page at the Whisperer in Darkness and a like it, and I will let you know when I am streaming again. And if you have any ideas what you'd like to see me stream, let me know. Let me know in the comments. Also, make sure you check out my work with Great Old Ones Gaming. The latest episode, where Off to Lang is on, is up now at thegreatoldonesgaming.com. So check out those two things. If you haven't done so already, my preview of the Dream Eaters expansion is up on YouTube, as well as we will be having the card reviews for Union and Disillusion will be up at some point, probably in a few weeks, not anytime soon. But definitely check out the Facebook page and connect with me so I can let you know when streams are happening, and so you can get in and let me know what you would like to see in the future. So that is going to do it for me today. I'm thanks to everyone who showed up, John Kenyon, Cryo Shark. Cryo Shark, you can always check out the hopefully, if everything worked out properly. This is the first time I've used Restream with YouTube, Twitch, and Mixer, so hopefully, if everything worked out properly, there'll be a replay on YouTube. You can catch the entire stream there. And if not, I will be back probably Friday, 10 o'clock Eastern time, or sorry, noon Eastern time, 10 o'clock my time, and we will play some more Arkham Horror LCG. So thanks again to everyone who showed up. And for your help, it's a lot easier to play the game when you've got some input, people helping you out, pointing out plays that you may not have thought about in the first place. And it certainly saved me in this game. So thanks again to everyone. And I hope to see you again on the next stream, and keep your eyes out on the channel for more updates. Until the stars are right, keep your shotgun close and your Elder Sign closer. Take care out there, and happy investigating.